Good morning, everyone. I know there's a lot of talking, bear with me, but before I begin, I feel like we need to wake up a little bit. So let's do a quick little exercise, yeah? Really simple, I just want y'all to be loud, okay? So when I say loud and, I want to hear it clear from the audience. Really loud, all right? So when I say loud and, y'all say clear!
It's okay.
See? All right, okay. When I say loud and, y'all say
clear!
Loud and
clear!
Loud and
clear!
Good, thank you. All right, that's my speech.
Appreciate
it. Sorry. Yeah, my name is Billy. Thank you all for being here. It definitely means a lot for all of us to, you know, care about our community and care about, you know, our peoples, our cultures, just where we project forward. Just a little bit of what I've been up to, that stuff. I was in Seattle a month ago doing a competition here, and I was in Seattle before that in November doing a reading and taking photos and doing a little bit of breaking and modeling shots on the side because you always got to promote your own brand, right, about yourself. Next slide, please. All right, so this was in Seattle, the top two photos. We lost in the top 8 out of like 100 crews with my brother here and then another dope boy from Japan. So we lost those crewmates. I was like, oh man, but you know, we still represented. So, and it was going to be out in Seattle. Next slide, please. After that, we did our 15-year anniversary for our crew. So my crew's called the Calamities. I created it alongside my brother. We represent San Diego. We really just try to put San Diego on the map along with you know, ourselves and our city and whatnot. So, so that's my crew, that's my parents, my mom, my stepdad, my stepbrother. They kind of surprised us at the jam. And you know, throwing a summit event is like really crazy. Throwing a breaking event is crazy. I had to judge it, which meant that everyone is your friend, but at the end of the night, no one is your friend because you just judge, you know, you voted against them. It's just, you know, nature of the beast. All right, next slide. So what I also like to do is, not by choice, but maybe by choice, I do like to document and capture community events in San Diego. You know, especially our cultural stuff. This was a promotion event for one of our monks at our main temple. I like to shoot the Lao'd and Clear. You're gonna see a lot more photos. So, yeah, someone, another photographer captured me, which is kind of nice to get to shoot each other sometimes, you know. Next slide, please. Yeah, so on the poetry front, I sold a book at my event. I actually get a lot of dancers buying my work. So, to this day, I think I sold over 500 copies, you know, for the past few years, which was great. We got a lot of work to do, but that's just a lot of learning for Samsung Press and a lot of promoting on our end. We have to be the authors, the salespeople, the promoters, and the managers and whatnot, right? And yeah, I love to read poetry. I can't memorize any of it, but I write it. Next slide. This one is, his name is Colin. He's one of the reasons why I am motivated to continue to write and continue to be the person that I am. I am definitely not perfect. I got a lot to work on myself. But you know, Colin's a young, he's a youth, he's Lao and Lu, a really bright kid, and he ran up to me and he was like, I want to buy your book. And when he finally bought my book, he said he read it, and I was like, yeah, because people 3 times their age don't read my book. but anyway, it's just motivating, and whatever I can do for the youth and for him and for others to at least provide the path, or just to say that, hey, it's possible for me to be someone like the suspect on the left, you know, but better. You know, just being able to be like, look, I don't just have to follow one route in a technical realm. I can be an artist, you know, or I can be into entrepreneurship. I can do anything. It sounds very cliche, but I think for our community, if some of us who don't see it may not believe it. Does that make sense? So like whether you're into food and fashion or whatever, like you just need faces just be like, I'm possible, and I could perhaps do better, as we all should cater to do better than where we're at now. Yeah? Okay, so without further ado, you could either look at the photos, which is going to beat my speech, or you could listen to my speech, or, you know, I urge you to do both. Yeah? All right, here we go. Good morning, fellow Lao Americans, allies, friends, and community folks. I welcome you with my words. I welcome you to this congregation of human beings who have a story to tell you, all of which branch out to be unique, powerful, and beautiful in their own way, all of which roots beneath the dirt and land lying beside the Mekong River. We present this year's Writer Summit with a theme, Lao'd and Clear. What does being Lao mean? How clear do we have to be? I wonder about similar things when I was younger. There was a need to preserve my culture, my parents and elders would say. We switched sides speaking. I spoke in broken Lao, and they spoke in broken English. Through the years, I am sure many of us received similar talks about cultural preservation. Many first and second generation folks have a duty instilled upon us to be the bearers of our family's history, while being spearheads for our future's direction, the in-betweeners. I've struggled and challenged myself to reflect on the past, assess the present, and ponder the future all at the same time, regarding what balance means among other concepts. Many of us grew up with nothing. We had to create the magic, and with what was there. This notion is at the very core of hip-hop dating back in the 1970s. To celebrate one's identity when none was given to them, so they created their own identities, like superheroes in comics. They rose from the bottoms of the beat to bounce, spin, push the powers of the body to fly, all while moving to the song being played, all while holding the mic, dropping heat, moving entire crowds with their voice. Those acts of expressions, screams for warm bodies to witness what was going on. It demands a respect through emotions that command attention. The notion to create in the mix of a bleak environment feels all too familiar in this way. This is important because being Lao'd and being hip-hop are quite one and the same at its core. If you notice any Lao parties, any Lao celebrations, there's an MC, 4 or 5 million of them. There's usually art displayed, like how it is here, backdrops around the wall, just like graffiti at a venue. There's dancing going on, singing, and especially musicians bring life into the room, like DJs do, you know, at hip-hop jams. We have our Lao version of Getting Low, you know, called Salam, right? And you know, that song is like way, way older than any hip-hop song that told you to get low. So, you know, I feel like we're hip-hop, right? You know what song I'm talking about? Are we gonna play it tonight or something? No? Salam, salam, get low? No? I'm not really good. Okay, but you get what I mean. And then we have a call and response, right? When I say it loud, then y'all say it clear. Or like, more and more, everyone's like, woo, you know? There's a call and response, it's very hip-hop. Or maybe hip-hop is very loud. Anyway, but why is this all important? I believe it ties into the elements of what being Lao means. The way we express ourselves through the arts, stories, ghost stories, and songs is itself a Lao'd act. And when I say Lao'd, I mean the tenacity of commanded attention, demanding your respect without literally yelling for it. Because we are Lao'd, it is intrinsic that what we do has a loudness to it. You cannot walk away and have it disappear. If you were an artist,
and you were Lao'd, oh, battery's up.
Take too much time, right? All right, if you are an artist and you are Lao American, you don't have to say you are, but you should be bold in the inclusion of your identity if you choose to do so. Do not be afraid. You can't create art for art's sake because we all have to be disciplined in our crafts, but you cannot separate yourself from your identity. So embrace it. Relish in the idea that who we are fills the bottle of creativity rich with content. Traditional dances, myths, food, fashion, language, and Lao approaches to a way of life become critical components. You can embed those facets into your craft, with subtlety or with full-on conviction. But whatever you choose, it needs to be clear. Clarity comes from the masterful delivery of the message. The audience must feel what you say, and it must leave with an impression. They must respect the fact that you have all the technique and skills in your repertoire, and you make it look effortless. Nothing is easy though. I encourage you to discipline yourself and motivate yourself to keep improving. There exists a collective upbringing of our community if we all work hard together. I come from a family that was close to our temple. We worked to help contribute to its development for over two decades alongside many families. My mom has an import shop that sells Lao and Thai music, Lao gifts, sing. My first experience with dancing was through traditional Lao dances for Lao New Year's at the temple. My first performance was an embarrassing one where I gave up in the middle of the set and cried because my feet was burning from the black tarp. Still embarrassing. My house has been host of parties with the keyboard of my dad blasting through the speakers still live at 2 a.m. as a kid. While there was ruckus outside, I fell asleep peacefully. I also was present when my grandmother rested peacefully forever, as well as my grandfather, half an hour later after he decided to rest forever. I was there through the funeral ceremonies as well as Yatan Sintong for Wat Lao Puram's funeral. I was there through many Lao ceremonies regarding weddings, festivals, religious periods of the year. For some reason, all filled with music, all filled with laughter, even during the darkest times. These notions are subliminal messages. Many of these experiences are common among us, but not told in the mainstream. That needed to change. One of my mentors, like my metaphysical mentors, Jude Jordan, she said, write or be written, so write we must do. We must express what we do. To express ourselves is to exist. We are all tired of the constraints our current status quo gives us, that we are not visible. As artists in various mediums, we should not shy away. As ambassadors and supporters of our community, we should not shy away. As members of this world who long for a home, for many of us who have forcefully or willingly separated from that home, we must not shy away sharing our stories. So what do? I incorporate little things in all my crafts. As a poet, I draw inspiration from my family's experience. Can you pause it? Or go back. I draw from my personal journey, coming from an age through uncertain phases of my life, always on the edge. I came to America around age 2, so I chose not to solely write about what I did not experience concerning the secret war, but I wanted to give my family a voice who have. I hope to give them a voice in a space that wanted to sweep these stories under the rug. I interviewed them, some of them, and created poems and stories out of it. I wrote poems about personal experiences coming up in Southeast San Diego, growing up as a Lao kid in a gang-heavy neighborhood where some blocks had friends and others had enemies that you weren't aware of, but you were caught up in their troubles anyway. I wrote about love, its presence, and the challenge of it, and the lack of it growing up. I write about our war, our refugee journey, our diaspora. But the fun of all of this is that I don't need to be a historian. I do not need to write a memoir, nothing wrong with that. I can instead learn about the stories and create from it via poetry. The challenge is to make it as visceral as possible. That's where the power thrives. We can create worlds. As a people, I draw inspiration from Lao dances as well as Southeast Asian forms of martial arts and mythical imagery. You'll probably see some tonight. It's an incorporation of my being while keeping the essence of breaking intact. As a photographer, I play this role of documenting the community's events. But if I have to shoot these events, I do it my way. I do incorporate faces, the feeling and the wavelengths of emotion, because I seek to humanize our experiences, bringing them to life through visuals. All my work aims to be as loud as possible so that no one can deny our presence. To just document is just to brush off our culture as static. And I want to make sure that everyone knows we are a living, breathing organism as a culture. We are living and breathing, not static. I hope that through these three art forms, I can welcome an audience to fall in love with the content while not catering to any particular experience. I seek to draw them in my world in a welcoming manner. One thing we must be aware of is the intersectionality of our experiences in retrospect to others. The term refugee is weaved into our history, such as the case for other people in this world. Bombs can be the difference between a home and a homeland. To be an artist is to be a healer to many. If we do not own these traumatic experiences, if we do not acknowledge the good and the bad from our history, we will be tied down to a dichotomy of who is right and who is wrong. That is dangerous finger pointing. So instead, I navigate through art. It crosses boundaries, it destroys barriers, and effectively breaks the ice, so folks can submerge into a narrative they've never interacted with. For example, Legacies of War. Can you go to slide 35, please? For example, Legacies of War, headed by Jean-Marc Mosa, is a powerful vehicle to enlighten the public on the history of Laos. Laos being still the most bombed country to this day on the PowerPoint. The organization aids the effort to remove the unexploded cluster bombs, UXOs, so people can live normal lives without walking and having legs pull off. Lives are still taken from UXOs to this day. We see this narrative being played again and again and again and again in other world countries. This is an example of intersections between various refugee communities. I felt the parallels of what was happening today in the bombings in Syria were the ones many of our family members had to live through. No matter who is to blame, the families suffer. They must separate and they must try to live in a place foreign to them to call it home. We must be understanding of that. And with this, can you switch to the next slide? I have a new poem that I wrote for it, and it's called, it's about these intersectionalities. It's called "A Bomb Does Not Discriminate." Photos by Brian's Secret Archive. A bomb does not discriminate. It detonates, blasts skin, does not care what color. A bomb does not discriminate, cares not what's for dinner. Lamb noodle curry, sticky rice, ramen noodles, or porridge. Bombs smash past windows, engulfs limbs in dust before the oven warms up. A bomb grasps children by the face, swap beds with iron tombs, feed mouths with fragments of lead, flame and gasoline boiling flesh just in time for night prayer. A bomb does not discriminate, does not care if a Muslim cries to Allah, or if a Buddhist chants Satu in tears, or a Christian sighs amen at a funeral. They all stand on the same soil. The planes still saw, bombs still smash, wiping human tears along with their souls. It will fall, gash necks open, fry blood in any city, any home, cares not when to explode. Hiroshima, 1945. All of the 1970s in Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, 2011, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 2017 in Syria, still counting. Bombs fly through time, been colorblind for centuries. A bomb does not discriminate. It burns, bites with steel fangs, napalm melts, seems the coming of death, no segregation guaranteed. A bomb does not discriminate, so why do you? The key is not to be safe. You can keep playing. The key is not to be safe, to not take the safe route. I'd rather not jump into the kind of work that solely aims to be relatable to the Lao community, but also must be adamant in letting people know who I am and express that to its core, being Lao'd. I'd rather not cater towards one demographic, grab a huge following, and sit back on a success. My narratives must have some kind of purpose, even if I don't know what that purpose is. But when I do, I must deliver it, with conviction, again. The message must have clarity in its foundation. There are opportunities to go deeper within myself, and what can be defined as Lao'd. A lot of this inspiration stands right before us. So for this weekend summit, I encourage you to take that chance, to be vulnerable, to listen to others and channel what they share. I urge you to let your guard down and soak in the stories so that you can take it home and reflect on what you need to do to get Lao'd. This community is actualizing a wonderful renaissance, currently through art, music, food, fashion, and academia. Now is the time to care about Lao America. Now is the time. I am including all ages and generations in this. We have it in our sights to shine in our own wavelength, without precedent. That leaves room for us to carry 40 years to come, where we don't need to follow what others have done. Rather, we dance away forward through our path. We march as we do during Lao New Year parades, smiling, hitting gongs, hitting drums, shouting and being loud. No longer will we be afraid to try, fail, and keep moving. But we must write, we must draw, we must act, we must sing. We must express with ownership the beauty of Lao. So move on with the Lao self, people. Let's get the summit moving. Let us define the kind of narrative we want for the future. I will end with a quote by one of our community's most notable leaders, Brian Balora, who's present in this room, on the topic of flags at the center of our community. He said, "A lot of people die for both of them, some by choice and others less so. When possible, I try to respect that there was an idea of Lao's both sides felt was worth dying for. And that is the Lao's I am interested in us growing. The one that is worthy of our blood, that we drunk for the next generation." Oh, and finish your book. Thank you all. Saatu, let's keep rocking. One thing is, I do gotta give a shout out to Brian. Please stand up really quick. You are at the center of this. Stand up, please. You're pretty tall yourself. So this is a 10-year anniversary of his first book. And he also got a National Endowment for the Arts 10 years ago. So this is like the 10-year anniversary. I think writing is very important. And a strong foundation and staple for how we move forward and how we project forward. And not only just in academia, in all aspects. So, yeah. One more time. Anyway, I'm here all weekend. You can connect with me. My contact is up there and everywhere. If you have any questions on what I do and how I navigate through my own stuff, you know, I definitely would love to share that. And I want to hear from you all too. So, anyway, thank you.